Hello, welcome to Liverpool Live TV. I'm Ben, and today we're at Eric's speaking to Ian Broudie.
Hiya.
How are you?
I'm good, you? Yeah.
I'm fine. It's lovely to have you here. It's lovely to have you in Liverpool, in a venue that you used to work in.
Yeah, I did. I've spent many a time here all day. It looks a little bit different. I haven't quite got my bearings, and it's a long time since I've been in here. So, to get used to it a little bit. Yeah.
It's obviously all changed and stuff. So what sort of job did you do when you was here?
Well, there was a guy called Roger Eagle who used to run the club, who was a very kind of eccentric mentor, really, in a way, for all the Liverpool musicians. And he used to, I used to kind of hang around. Matthew Street was very different then. It was like all derelict warehouses, cobblestones, and there was a big fridge outside. And it was three big fridges, and they used to have ice sculptures in them. And there was a guy called Charlie Alexander who used to have all ice sculptures on the road. And a little bit further down, when I was a kid, I'd just left school, and I remember kind of wandering into Matthew Street, and there was a big building, and it said on it, the Liverpool School of Music, Dream, Art, and Pun. And I thought, I've got to go in there, you know what I mean? So, and that's kind of how the vibe of the place started. And then Eric's opened up at the top of the road, and Probe at the bottom of the road, and it was a bit of a holy trinity of the three places, where everyone, I suppose we were all on the dole and just aspiring musicians, and it was a place where you could see young men. So I used to kind of hang about at the top there, and Roger, who was a great fella, had been a DJ in the 60s and stuff, and he used to, which was pretty cool for just some lad, and he had his record collection, was his pride and joy, and he used to lend me a couple of albums, three albums, and he'd say, bring them back in 2 days, and I'll swap them for another two. This is dub. This is R&B. This is
your own, like, musical
Stones.
Library.
And he just showed me a lot of music that I'd never heard before.
So then, from that sort of borrowing music and bringing them back, is that where you sort of your influences came from people like the Rolling Stones? And
from everything, really. And but it was the time of punk rock, so there was, you know, the start of punk rock and stuff. A lot of the bands playing here. And I used to be in a band called Big in Japan, and Roger was the manager. So we used to rehearse in here in the day, and we used to kind of make some cash doing the loading for the bands and DJing a bit and doing anything we could around the place, you know. So we'd kind of be in here a lot of the time, really, through the daytimes. And I'd get to see and talk to the bands and see the sound checks, and, you know, it was kind of a big influence, I suppose, you know.
So it was the punk rock era. You was in this band, Big in Japan, and you were sort of, did you feel sort of embarrassed because you like the Beatles? I've read in an interview that you felt embarrassed because you was in this punk scene and you liked
the
Beatles.
It's not quite that. No, I think what used to happen was, because Big in Japan were kind of just noise and really influenced by the Velvet Underground, really. But what happened was, actually, it was Pete Wiley. Just thought you shouldn't be in a group if you liked the Beatles, because they were the opposite of punk.
Yeah.
And I was like, no, they are the embodiment of punk.